You're listening to the Rise with Tori podcast, where we explore and live out the intersection between faith, fitness, and wellness. I'm your host, Tori, and I'm so glad you're here today as we strive to grow spiritually and physically with a God-first mentality for lasting change. I am so excited to share what the Lord has placed on my heart today, but it might be a little hard, it might be a little spicy, but it's something that's kind of been burning in me for a little while, and I feel like the Lord's like, Tori, you gotta speak truth in love, but you gotta speak truth. And it's something that I know for myself that I need to press into as well. So it's not a me preaching at you, but this is a teaching time for all of us here together. But first, let's just set the stage for what we're gonna do for workout wise. We're gonna just do pretty much endurance for the next 30 minutes. We're gonna work our way. So we're gonna start at a warm up, work our way up to a nice like 6 to 7 on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being like out of breath, you just can't even go anymore, and 1 being just getting out of bed. I want us right now to be at about a 4 to 5 to warm up, whatever that looks like, walking, biking, whatever that looks like for you. Your 4 to 5 is not going to be the same as someone else's 4 to 5, so it's different for everybody. And then we're going to work our way up. As we get warm, we're going to work our way up to about 6 or 7, and I want you to try and maintain that for our entire time together. There might be some times that I'll invite you to push a little bit, but I just want you to focus on that steady state, your breath work, your form, but also hearing the message and hearing what God wants to speak to you today. So let's just have some body awareness right now. How's your body feeling as you warm up? Maybe a little tight, maybe a little sore. It's okay, just notice it. Don't judge or come down on yourself for it, but just be aware. Be aware of what your body is feeling, especially as you're warming up. Sometimes for me, my hips get a little tight and I gotta kind of loosen it up, or maybe stop and just kind of stretch a little bit more. So be aware of that. And then I want you to take a big breath in through your nose. And now as you release, drop your shoulders out of your ears, relax your hands, maybe shake your arms out a little bit. Good, and maybe just roll your shoulders. Good, you're probably starting to feel your heart rate begin to rise a little bit. So what I want you to do is work your way up to about a 6 or 7. You should be able to have a brief conversation with someone if they were there at a 6 or 7, but at a point where maybe you gotta stop the conversation for a little bit, if that makes sense. Good. All right, let's move into our verse for today. Our focus comes from Matthew 16:24-28. I'm gonna read it and then we'll pray. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life because of me will find it. For what will it benefit someone if he gains the whole world yet loses his life? Or what will anyone give in exchange for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will reward each according to what he has done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." Lord, thank you for who you are. Thank you that you invite us into fellowship with you. Thank you for caring and loving us and taking care of us. Thank you for just your word and sometimes challenging passages that call us higher and call us to examine and press into those hard places. God, use this time together to just speak to us. Help us to hear from you and what you want to say, and let me step out of the way. Let it be your words that come through my mouth, Lord. Let it be you, not me, but you. Help us to move well and keep our eyes on you the entire time. We love you. We praise you. Amen. So let's set the stage for this passage. In Matthew 16, we see Peter confessing who Jesus truly is. Jesus predicts his death. Then Peter puts his foot in his mouth like he likes to do. And y'all listen, sometimes we give Peter a hard time. We do the same thing, right? But then Jesus rebukes him. And in verse 23, it says, Jesus turned and told Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me because you're not thinking about God's concerns, but human concerns." And that leads us, that verse 23 leads us up to our passage today. Verse 24 says, "If anyone wants to follow Jesus, they must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me," or follow him, to be kingdom minded. And that's what in verse 23 that Jesus told to Peter. He said, "You are concerned with human things and not things of God." So if you've been a Christian long enough, I'm sure you've heard these verses or these phrases before, but here's the thing. Two things stand out to me. So in that verse 24, it says, a follower of Jesus, which is a disciple, and that's what the disciples were, but we're all disciples as well. And then the second one is to deny ourselves. So follower of Jesus and to deny ourself. So let's just sit with that for a moment. Follower of Jesus and deny ourselves. He says, if anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. The question is, how can you and I follow Jesus better? What does it look like to be a disciple? What is the prerequisite to be a disciple? So first, let's talk about a disciple. What is that? A disciple is a learner, a follower, and here we are talking specifically about discipleship to Jesus. We are Jesus's disciples. We are Jesus's followers, and we learn from him. These are familiar verses, but maybe like myself, you know, we read through it and we know it and we refer to it. We kind of skim through the surface, but we never really sank roots into it and dug deep into what these words really truly mean. So we're going to do that today. We're going to talk about that a little bit. So according to Jesus, following him is not the path to self-fulfillment or self-discovery like the world teaches. You know, we hear find yourself or self-help messages or books. It's all the rage. It's out there of finding yourself. You do you, be you, self-help. But the Bible tells us that following Jesus is the path of self-denial. That kind of stings a little bit. The path of self-denial. In other words, following Jesus is not having the good life now, but it's losing your life now. And maybe you're thinking, you're like, are you sure that's what Jesus meant? So let me pull up some other verses. Let me share some other verses so we can kind of, get a grasp of this and listen a little bit more about what Jesus says. So Luke 14, in verse 26, he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. That sounds a little harsh. And you may be thinking, what? Like, this is hate. But that's not what that verse is saying. So really, it's saying that our value, our esteem, our love for Jesus is so great. Our reverence for him, following him, is so great that we are willing to even deny ourselves to follow him. And that loving him looks so much grander than, you know, you love your kids, you know, you love your spouse, you know, you love people in your life, but it should look like you hate them because of your love for Jesus is so much more. Does that make sense? So it's not saying literally hate them. It's saying you love them, But your love for Jesus is so much more that it actually looks like you hate them because you love him so much more. Now notice that it's hard to balance both of these things where he says, if you're not willing to do this, you cannot be my disciple. It's impossible to follow Jesus if you love yourself and your old life more than him. Let me say that again. It is impossible to follow Jesus if you love yourself and your old life more than him. Now listen, it's not saying to not love ourselves and to not care about ourselves. It's the total opposite, but it says to deny ourselves and pick up our cross and follow him, in that sometimes our flesh wants certain things, to do certain things, to say certain things, but we deny our flesh, we press down that flesh and follow Jesus. And what would Jesus want us to do? What would Jesus have us say? How would he have us act? So if you want to follow Jesus, there is a prerequisite. It's you must be willing to deny yourself. You must be willing to say no to your personal ambitions in this world. You must be willing to say no to fame and fortune. You must be willing to say no to the applause of men. You must be willing to say no to the comforts and conveniences of this life. I don't know about you, but there are so many times that I don't deny myself because I want to be comfortable. I want convenience. I want to tend to myself and get what I want and not deny myself and step into hard or do hard things to follow him. We must be willing to engage the world and step into hard places to make more disciples. Discipleship to Jesus is not self-centered, it's cross-centered. You follow Jesus not to get stuff. You follow Jesus to get Jesus. I'm going to say that again. You follow Jesus not to get stuff, not to pray, Lord, give me this, give me a good life, give me comfort, give my kids this. We follow Jesus to get more of him, to get more of Jesus. And that means you value Jesus above the stuff of life. And you're willing to deny the stuff of life. So what does discipleship look like in our everyday lives? Discipleship has been this hot topic word for me recently. I actually was the discipleship coordinator at my church before we moved. And it's just one of those places that God has called me to, which I think we all are disciples and should be focusing on discipleship, but it's just been such a burning in my heart that God wants us to be discipling, one, him discipling us, but us discipling each other. And so what does discipleship look like? Once you become a disciple or a follower of Jesus, we are then to go and make more disciples or make more followers of Jesus. Matthew 28:19-20, it's probably another familiar one for you. The Great Commission, it says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. I'm going to take a little pause here. And I'm going to invite you to push. I'm going to invite you to push up to an 8, maybe even a 9 here for the next, let's do 30 seconds, okay? And I want you to press into that. One, being a disciple for yourself, denying yourself. And two, discipleship, going and making disciples. Press into that. Pray about it for a minute, okay? Here we go. Ready and go. You got it. Come on. You can do hard things. Keep going. Keep pressing. even with this message stirring inside of you, press into it. You got about 10 seconds. Come on, finish it out. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Good. Rest. All right. Now don't completely stop, but bring yourself back down to maybe a 5. Catch your breath. And then slowly work your way back up to that 6 or 7, that nice steady pace, that what that looks like for you. Good. So I'm going to read Matthew 28:19-20 again. Go therefore and make disciples. Go therefore, I'm going to change that. Go therefore and make Jesus followers of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Jesus has, in this passage, right before, he has just been resurrected and he encountered his disciples and gave these instructions. The Great Commission, like I said earlier, it's what we know when we become a Christ follower and we're growing and we hear, go therefore, make disciples. But here's the thing. I think a lot of times we think go and make disciples is a mission trip across the globe or serving at a church camp, or becoming a leader at a church, or like these big positions that are like, well, I gotta go and have all these people under me or influence, and that's how I will go and make disciples. And don't get me wrong, yes, those are very important things. Those are the go. Those are things that we need. We need people in those places. We need missionaries. We need people going across the globe. We need people leading churches and discipling in those areas. But I think sometimes we forget that the go is also in our local communities, in our schools, in our gyms, wherever we go. In your going is where discipleship happens, in the going, when we are going about our lives. Now, it doesn't mean it's just a willy-nilly, like, oh, you know, discipleship will just kind of happen. We do have to be intentional, but in your going is where discipleship happens. So what do I mean by that? Let's break it down. Oh, we can really break it down. But what I mean by that is, as you're living, you are dying to yourself as a disciple. You're at the store and you see a mom struggling, and maybe she's having a hard time, or kids are crying, and mommy, I want this. So you stop and you help. Maybe you're running behind and you're running late and you gotta get to where you gotta go and you have things. But in that moment, you stop and you help and you put yourself aside for a moment to be the light. Ask to pray for her, invite her to church, whatever that looks like. Ask the Holy Spirit. Maybe at your kids' sports teams or sporting events, you invite a couple to have dinner at your house and you just get to know them. Maybe you reach out to your neighbors, and maybe you don't really know your neighbors. I want to challenge you with that. Do you know your neighbors' names? If you have neighbors, we had neighbors in Florida, but we only had a couple because we had some land, but now we have legit neighbors by us. And so our goal is to get to know each and every one of their names. Get to know them. Pray for them. Better yet, in your churches, do life together. Here's the thing. Stop. We got to stop showing up like we have it all together. And we got to get real and vulnerable in our churches. The churches is, when we go to church, like, yes, we are the church, we are the body. So everywhere we go, we are the church. But when we show up in our churches, we also have to be vulnerable and be real with each other. We can't show up like it's a museum and I have it all together and I got it figured out. And No, be real and be honest and be vulnerable. And it's hard. It is so hard, but that's part of denying ourselves when I want to put on a front and act like everything is okay. Part of denying myself is saying, you know what? I'm gonna be real and I'm gonna show up honest, and that might help somebody else out. Or I might have questions about my faith or about the Bible, and I'm gonna ask those questions because it will generate conversation in our small groups. It will generate conversation in our churches, and it might help somebody else. So share your struggles, pray together. Be willing to be inconvenienced. Be willing to get uncomfortable. Be willing to be vulnerable. Deny ourselves. Listen, I am convinced that the more I'm in church and around church people and just doing ministry and doing life, I am convinced it is not a sermon or a great message or just like sitting in church, right, and hearing a message that transforms people or makes disciples. I'm convinced that's not what does it. It's engaging in our communities, the people we do life with. God made us to be in community together. Get in a small group, y'all. If you've been hurt by a small group, I am so sorry. I'm so sorry that people were people. We're people too, and I bet we have hurt people too. We might not even realize it. We have to have forgiveness and make room and make allowance for people's faults because we're all sinful. But I'm telling you, I have witnessed the beauty of small group and doing life together, and I have watched people grow in their faith because they were vulnerable, grow in their faith because they showed up, denied themselves and wanting to act perfect and ask questions and press into those hard places. It's reading God's word for ourselves and studying scriptures on our own. I want to say, you do know that you have the same Holy Spirit in you as your pastor. If you are a believer, that same Holy Spirit is in you that's in your pastor, or the pastor that you see on social media that like is on fire. Now the giftings might be a little different, but you have the same Holy Spirit. You can ask Him to guide you and teach you. Our leaders can guide us and help us, but we have to do the work. We have to put it into practice. That is part of being a disciple, is doing. We don't do to earn it. We don't do to gain our salvation or to gain being right with God. We do it out of obedience of, God, I love you so much and I want to follow you, and that we do it in surrender. That's part of sanctification. When we do the works, that is part of our sanctification. We're working it out. We don't need more consumption. We need more activation. I love here at Revelation Wellness, we talk about embodiment and doing and getting our bodies involved. That is part of that activation. We can't wait for the pastor to give us the message and then they do all the work and then they spoon feed us and they just give it to us like a spiritual glutton. We just sit in our churches and we just, okay, gimme, gimme, gimme. We take it in and we take our notes. But we have to then turn and go and do something with it. Go and make disciples, whatever that looks like, however God is calling you to do that. Don't get complacent as a body. Don't get complacent as a disciple. It's so easy, y'all. I can do it too. Where we get comfortable and we're coasting and we do our daily things and go here and there and our kids and you know, I read my Bible, check the box. But really, discipleship. I am the church, you are the church, and we are disciple makers. We are disciple makers. Discipleship is not just for the super spiritual or pastors or teachers. It is for us all. It is commanded for us all. Go and make disciples. But why are we not going out? Why do we say, well, that's not for me? That's for fill in the blank. That's for that ministry. Or we say, well, I'm a light at work. People see my actions and they know. They see how I act and how I talk. And y'all, that's great. But we have to speak. We have to speak the gospel. We have to speak truth. We have to invite people to church. We have to get in community with non-believers and teach them and share the gospel. It says, I don't have it written down and I can't think of it off the top of my head, but how will they know if they do not hear? They can see your life, but how will they know the gospel if they don't hear it? We have to say it. Or we think, I'm not knowledgeable enough. I don't know enough scripture. I'm not spiritual enough. Or I have to raise my kids first. I have to take care of them first. Or it's not safe. Maybe you are being called to missions or to go somewhere hard and you're like, well, it's not safe. The church will handle it. That's their job. Y'all, that is a lie from the enemy. So why do we stay comfortable? Why don't we deny ourselves? Why don't we pick up our cross and follow him? It's because being a disciple is costly. It's costly. It costs Jesus and his disciples their lives. And I think sometimes we're not willing to count the cost. We're not willing to deny ourselves. We are so me, and I'm not trying to shame you. I'm trying to help us see as a nation, we're all about me. And it should be all about him. Disciple making means not just sharing the gospel, but sharing our own selves, gladly spending time and being spent for the souls of others. It's about giving and giving and giving. When I go back to that deny myself, how do I deny myself? Well, I have to deny what I want and give. I have to then go and give and speak and pray and minister and fellowship. But did not Jesus say himself, it is more blessed to give than to receive? And so the hearts of his disciples in our labors to disciple others, we're learning to say, it makes me happier for you to have my time and my energy and my attention to give it to you than to keep it for myself. It makes me happier to give it away than to keep it for myself. Disciple making is not easy. It will cost everything. It's costly. Our whole lives. To deny ourselves and pick up our cross and follow him. Going back to verse 27. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life because of me will find it. For what will it benefit someone if he gains the whole world yet loses his soul? But y'all, there's good news. There is a reward. Not only the gift of seeing others come to Christ, or watching them grow in their faith, y'all, it's so rewarding to see people get it and to pour into them and them give their life to Christ and grow and become sanctified. But in turn, we see more disciples being made. So we go and make disciples, and then they go and make disciples, and it continues on. But the last and final reward of making disciples is to hear Christ say, well done, good and faithful servant. There can be no greater reward than hearing the Almighty God, the Sovereign One of the universe say, well done. Thank you for joining me, friends. I hope this message touched you and maybe pushed you in certain areas to just press into Him more and to be a disciple and a disciple maker. Lord, we thank you for the gift of salvation, for the gift of denying ourselves to follow you wherever it is that you would have us go. Lord, help us to deny ourselves and our selfish, sinful nature, Lord, and to lean into you and where you would have us go and how you would have us go and make disciples. Lord, we thank you for this time. We love you and we praise you, God. You are so worth it. You are worthy and worth it all, Lord. And if we are not feeling that, Lord, help us to continue to praise and to seek you until we feel it in our bones. We feel it in our soul, Lord. Meet us in those places. We love you. In your name we pray.